recording right now, and back again to the presentations that we had. We're talking about the shortage of water, and the crisis related to the shortage of water can be related not only that the quantity is less, but there are some other problems associated with groundwater, like well failure, or definitely the declination of water table if it's not replenished by enough rain. The seawater intrusion, and it would be a problem if it's going to mix with freshwater aquifers, then we are going to talk about salinization of the freshwater that needs again to be desalinized or desalinated. The Great Sahara, which extends from the western shores of Morocco up to the eastern shores of Kingdom of Saudi Arabia, this is something which has a length of about, or width of about 4,000 kilometers, and it does not have a natural source for water. The Arabian Peninsula has no rivers at all. So we're talking about issues related to shortage of the existence of water in our area. Desertification is defined as the rate of increase of the arid land due to unregulated human activities. Solution of these problems, again, are going to be through industrial desalination, taking the salty water in oceans and seas and try to convert that into sweet water. Luckily, 7% of the population is living close to the shores, to the seashores, so the access of seawater is not really a big issue, because that's natural, that people will tend to move to the shores and have high population there. So the issue of having localized desalination systems is going to serve this high population. A global daily average of rainfall is about 2 into 10 to the power of 11 cubic meter, but it is not distributed evenly. There are some places that are suffering from the lack of rain, while other places are suffering from floods that are frequent due excessive rain. So that's an issue that in their places, I know that some of the heavily raining countries, they started to build like aquifers so that they can store the rain in them so that it can be used later. And I would think that even for the countries in which it does not rain frequently, having aquifers to store the water coming from the rain is a good idea as a source of water. Even if it rains slightly, or the quantities are less, but preserving this amount of water is a precious source. The way that it happens normally, or the natural water cycle, let me see if I have this in one of the slides that I have here. I would expect that it should be here. Yes, this is the natural water cycle in the figure that we have upper left. The solar energy heats the surface water of the ocean. Heating is going to, and actually it's heating and the concentration gradient. This is high concentration of water on the surface here and much less concentration in the air. So mass transfer occurs, evaporation occurs, and the vapor is going to rise when it's heated due to its low density, going above until it forms clouds. The wind is going to move the clouds into areas of very low temperature, where these clouds are going to condense and solidify into ice caps or icebergs, or into an area which is not that cold enough for condensation, and then it is converted from vapor into liquid water, and the water drops as rain. And then as the rain falls on the land, it penetrates through the soil and goes back again to the ocean. So we're talking about some sort of a complete cycle of the water. Evaporation and condensation is the key for all thermal desalination systems. You are creating vapor, and after that, the vapor is known to be pure. So when evaporation occurs, the vapor forms, leaving the salt behind. And the pure vapor, whenever it is condensed, then you are getting pure water. And we'll see that the most of or maybe all the thermal desalination systems are adopting this technology. The only addition to the technology here is that in many of them who are using low pressure, because as we decrease the pressure, the evaporation temperature decreases, and then you can have more vapor, and accordingly, you can have more production in your system. That's why you will see for the large capacity desalination systems, multi-stage flash desalination systems, multi-effect distillation systems, you'll find that there is a pressure gradient going from one stage to the other, or from one effect to the next one. And the high pressure at the beginning, lower pressure, lower, and the lowest pressure is usually at the last stage. This gradient in the pressure, the decrease in pressure, is going to guarantee that we are always getting an additional amount of vapor in each one of these stages or effects. The seawater composition is made up of several ions or several salts. Here are the most significant or important group of them. The chloride, it is 55% by mass of seawater. Sodium is about 30% of the mass of salts of the ocean or seawater. So we're talking about something like 85% of the water is basically sodium chloride. Sulfates are 7%, and sulfates is kind of ions that are making big problem, because all the hard scaling are coming from the sulfates, and getting rid of the sulfates is one of the innovations that came up lately, talking about different pretreatment processes, including nanotechnology or some other technologies that we have developed ourselves here in the department, and we tried to file them as patents that can segregate out not only the sulfates, but the magnesium and the calcium as well. Calcium is making the soft scale, sulfates are making the hard scale, and these are some sort of problems that we need to get rid if we need to use thermal desalination, because we are heating the seawater. As you are heating the seawater, you may reach for a point where precipitation of the salt is going to occur. The saturation becomes saturated. I mean that the solution becomes saturated, and supersaturated means that salt crystals are going to form. And as the crystals form, it covers the surface of the heat transfer equipment and make a layer of scaling, which is like an insulation layer. It affects the heat transfer rate, and the whole performance is degrading because of that. So whether it is issue of fouling, which is existence of dirt, which is carried by the water, biofouling, it could be like seawater creatures that can come in and cover the surface of the tubes. And that's, again, one of the problems that are facing us while we are doing systems that are dealing with water. Somebody had a question? If not, then I'll continue. Then we are talking about the carbonic acids. So CO2 is liberated sometimes upon heating the water. And when CO2 is generated, the problem with CO2 is that it's not condensable gas. And if we don't get rid of it, then it starts accumulating on this around the surface of the tubes. And again, it affects the heat transfer process. Accordingly, every desalination system of mainly large production, thermal desalination system, should have some sort of a venting system to get rid of the non-condensable gases. Then the bromine, the boric acid, and the strontium are of little quantities, and they depend on the location, which means that you may or may not find them according to the source and the quality of water that you are getting. I made a sketch of this slide last time when I was talking about you have a separation unit that separates the fresh water from the salty water, and which is the desalination system. It could be thermal or membrane, but you need some sort of an energy in. And now the cleverness is to desalinate the water with as less energy requirement as possible. Then your system becomes more efficient, and even the price of water becomes or makes more sense. Here are some of the old or some of the like simple technologies that we have for water desalination. I already talked about the rain cycle, which is located here, top left figure. The one below it is the oldest technology for desalination. This is the solar still. The solar still is basically some sort of a sealed box. This box is having walls that are made of insulating material, or maybe they are made of metal, but the metal is well insulated so that it does not leak heat to the surrounding. It controls the heat loss to the surroundings. At the basin here, we have water. It could be seawater or any low quality water. It is all sealed and it's covered with glass. Glass is transparent to short wavelength radiation. This is the greenhouse phenomenon, that the short wavelength radiation coming from a high temperature source can penetrate through the glass. And it penetrates through the glass. It is passing through the glass. It heats the water, and then the vapor will form. As the vapor forms, there's no place for it to escape. So what would do, it would condense on the inner surface of the glass plate. The glass plate is tilted with a certain angle. So the droplets that will form by condensation are going to slide and move down by gravity until they are collected here at the side. The solar stills would have very different or many shapes, as we will see next week when we talk about it in details. However, there is a problem associated with the operation of the solar stills, which is it has low productivity. You can have a solar still and the maximum amount of water that you can get from a 1 meter by 1 meter solar still, it could be something like not much more than 5 liters per day. So you're talking about a few milliliters per hour that will gather up to be, maybe it would range between 1 to 5 liters per day. And this is a very small quantity. If we are talking about a single person is expected to have a quantity of water, which is much more than what you see here. It's not only for drinking, but it's for drinking, for cooking, for washing, so many applications of the water that are needed other than drinking. But it seems that the solar stills are only good to provide water for drinking for maybe a couple of persons per day. What's the major problem with the solar still? It's not only that the quantity which is produced is less, but we have talked about the GOR last time, the gain output ratio, which is some sort of an energy effectiveness of the unit. How much water you are producing times how much energy needed to evaporate this water divided by the energy source. And the GOR for the solar stills is, you can hardly get values between 0.5 to 1. What's the problem? The problem is, as the water evaporates here and start rising up, it should condense at the surface. In order to condense the water, you need to get rid of the latent heat of condensation. Where will it go? It will be dissipated to the air. It will be absorbed by the glass and then convected away from the glass surface and maybe radiated away. So the amount of energy you have received, you have used it for evaporating the water, and you need to get rid of a similar amount of energy, which is the latent heat of condensation for water to convert from vapor to liquid. And you are not making use of this energy. In other words, we are not recovering the energy which is being wasted here. And that explains why the gain output ratio is low here, because you are losing tremendous amount of energy to the surrounding. It's a low quality energy, yes, but you are losing it. So the idea came after that, looking at the processes happening in a solar cell, it is basically heating. Solar energy is heating the water inside the cell. Evaporation, so vapor rises here due to the higher increase the temperature of the water level. And then condensation, which is occurring here at the inner surface of the glass. And the vapor is carried by the stagnant air here. And it's a natural convection sort of thing where the vapor is going to rise up until it is reaching the surface and condensing there. I talked about a greenhouse effect a while ago, which is actually what's happening in a solar still. In a solar still, we have glass or maybe polyurethane. Some of the plastics have the same property that it passes, it is transparent to short wavelength radiation. Short wavelength radiation, to remind you, this is the high frequency radiation or the radiation associated with high temperature sources. Nothing is more hot than the sun. So the short wavelength radiation from the sun passes through the glass and it gets in, it reaches the water, absorbed by the water, and then the water is getting heated. The water temperature is much lower compared to the sun, definitely. So the kind of radiation that leaves the water is long wavelength radiation. Glass does not pass the long wavelength radiation, which means that it's the whole box here is like a heat trap. It is trapping the energy in. It's allowing the energy to come in, but not allowing it to go out. And this is exactly what we refer to as the greenhouse phenomenon. You probably remember if you are going for maybe going to work or maybe going to buy something from the grocery or even going to pray, and you leave your car in the sun in a hot day and the glass is closed. When you get back, it's too hot. Why too hot? It's because of this phenomena. The glass of the car or the glazing is going to allow the radiation heat transfer in from a short wavelength radiation, but inside is a long wavelength radiation that will not be re-radiated back. And you are accumulating here inside the car more and more and more, to the extent that when you open it to drive, you cannot even touch the steering wheel because it's too hot. Sometimes a practical solution for that is just leave the glass a little bit open for two doors so that it makes like a convection current that would take this heat out. Even some of the advertisements of some small instruments or instrumentations that can be used is just a fan that you can put it, don't close the glass fully and put the fan here. It will rotate naturally because of the airflow through it due to the difference in density. And then as it rotates, it will take the hot air out and replace it by cold air in, so that when you get back, you'll find the car a little bit warm, but not too hot as it is expected to be. What is the improvement that can be done for a solar still? To answer this question, it would simply be separate the processes. We have a process of heating. Solar energy heats the water that penetrates through the glass, the energy. So heating should be separate. The evaporation process should be separate. This is air which is inside. So the evaporation process, it looks like you are humidifying the air. The air is being increased in its humidity. And then condensation, which is the dehumidification. It's the opposite now, condensation of the water in. So we have three processes, and the three processes are to be separated. The separation may allow us to do some sort of energy recovery. Although we will see next week that the solar stills, there are some versions of the solar stills with some attempts for energy recovery in there, especially for the multi-effect solar still. But generally speaking, being able to separate these units, you can design each unit and make a certain component for each unit designed separately, and then you can optimize it. And here came the idea of what we call the humidification, dehumidification, desalination system, which is the one that we see here at the right side. We are doing three different processes, heating, followed by humidification or evaporation, followed by dehumidification. In some other entitlement, we call it carrier gas extraction technology. We have a carrier gas, which is nothing more cheap and available than the air. So air is the carrier gas. We have water that which is being sprayed in the humidifier. We have air that's being heated, be it a solar collector or even an electric heater, whatever, or maybe even talking about making use of waste heat that is coming from an air conditioning system or coming from a chimney of a process heater, which is otherwise is being dissipated to the air. You can make use of this heat to heat the air, and the hot air is going to be admitted into a humidifier in which there are sprayers to spray the water. Hot air is going to pass by the water. The water is going to be heated, evaporated, and the vapor will be carried by the air, and the warm, humid air is going to enter to the dehumidifier where there are some sort of a tubes that are having cold water in to condense the water vapor from the air on the outside surface of the tubes. And meanwhile, and this is the issue of energy recovery here, that the water inside the tubes are going to be heated because they are going to receive the latent heat of condensation of the condensing vapor. They are going to be preheated, and after that, you are going to make use part of the energy that you have spent here. You are not going to throw it away by condensation, but you are going to preheat the water, and the preheated water is going to be sprayed here. High temperature is going to enhance the evaporation process. Then, as we will see when we reach to the chapter talking about the HDH systems, that we can have various classifications here. What we see in front of us here is what we call an open loop of water, open loop of air, or open loop air and water system. You may have the air in closed loop, or maybe the water in closed loop, or both. We are heating the air here, but alternatively, you can heat the water. All what we need is some high temperature, relatively high temperature, to occur in the humidifier. Why high temperature? Because when you are heating the air, its ability to absorb moisture increases, and we need the air to absorb as much moisture as possible so that it will condense it here. So we're going to get higher product. So you can heat air, heat water, heat both of them. You can have a closed loop or an open loop. You can use solar collector or any other source of energy, but at the end, try to make the process as efficient as possible. Here it is saying that a cycle goal of 4.5 is being recorded. Actually, this value has been almost doubled with years. So now we have created systems that can, the analysis says that they have much higher values of the goal compared to just 4.5. I mean, you could simply reach a values of 6, 7, or maybe approaching 8. For different desalination or for different HDH, humidification, dehumidification, desalination systems. So the previous ones were basically some sort of emerging technologies that can be worked at any scale. Normally they are low to medium scale. If you are going to talk about large scale of production of water, then these are the units that we see in front of us that can be utilized or can be used for that. What we see here basically is a combination of three different desalination systems. The one that we have to the right here is the RO system, reverse osmosis system. What's the idea behind RO system? We're bringing a container here. And in this container, there are two different types of waters that are separated by semi-permeable polymeric membrane with a supporting layer. In one side of the membrane, we have seawater. On the other side of the membrane, we have fresh water. If you bring it like this and leave it for a while, what is going to happen is you'll find that water level here in the freshwater part is going to reduce. And the water level in the salty water part is going to increase, which means that the flow is going to be from the freshwater side to the saltwater side. Why is that? Because the chemical potential of fresh water is higher than the chemical potential of salt water. So the flow is going to be from right to left. This is the osmotic phenomena. This is not what we want. Actually, we need to extract the sweet water from the seawater here. So what we do, we try to apply a pressure which is higher than the osmotic pressure of that salt. The osmotic pressure depends on the salinity. And this is why in the previous slide, when we were comparing the power requirement, we said that salinity of the Gulf is going to require more energy to desalinate compared to the salinity in the Mediterranean or in the Atlantic Ocean. So we have to apply a pressure here. The pressure should be higher than the osmotic pressure of this solution so that you can force the seawater to go through the membrane. This membrane is semi-permeable, which means that it allows the sweet water to pass in, allows the water molecules to pass. It does not allow most of the ions to pass. So we apply a pressure higher than the osmotic pressure, and then the reverse osmosis process occurs. So you are reversing the direction here. That's why it's called RO, or reverse osmosis. The osmosis itself is having water going from here to here, but you need the opposite. So you have to do reverse osmosis by applying pressure that should exceed the osmotic pressure of that salty water. So this is the RO. All it needs is pressure. So you're talking about pumps here, and pumping power is all what you need. Yeah, we need high pressure, definitely. I mean, for seawater, you need something like in the order of 60 to 70 times the atmospheric pressure, 60 to 70 bars, so that you can overcome the osmotic pressure. And the higher concentration of salt water are going to require higher energies as well. So we have the basic pump here should be a huge pump delivering huge amount of power to be able to push this salty water against the membranes and get fresh water on the other side. What we have on the left here are basically MSF on the top figure and MED in the lower figure. Let's start with the top figure. In the top figure, what do we have? We have water coming from the sea. This water enters the upper part of every one of these. These are three stages that we see in front of us here. In every one of them, the water which is coming here is coming from the sea. So it's at a temperature of about 20 to 30 degrees centigrade or so. So it's cold water relatively. It will enter inside the tubes. And here there's vapor. The vapor is going to come in contact with a colder surface. So the vapor will condense into water, and this is our product. As the vapor condenses, it is going to release its latent heat. So the water inside the tubes is going to be preheated. This is heat recovery I'm talking about. So water will be preheated here, and then preheated here, and then preheated here. In every stage, there is some sort of preheating to the incoming water or the feed water by the condensation of the vapor outside the surface of the tubes. It condenses, giving off its latent heat to the water which is being preheated. So you are talking about preheating the water until it reaches here the inlet of this heat exchanger. This heat exchanger is what we refer to as the brine heater. It is normally, or usually, some sort of a shell and tube heat exchanger. Inside the tubes, there is salty water. Outside the tubes, there is steam coming from a power plant. You are taking a line of steam from a back pressure turbine or a low pressure turbine, and the steam is going to condense here. While it condenses, it will give its latent energy to the water here, where you are going to heat the water to the maximum cycle temperature. We call it top brine temperature. Top brine temperature, previously in three decades back, it was in the order of 90 degrees centigrade. Now, typically, it's a value of 115 degrees centigrade. There are trials to go for 120 or even 130 degrees centigrade. In order to reach for high temperature for the brine, we have to worry about scaling. That's why there are some sort of chemical additives that are given to the water. It could be acids. And that's basically, they are anti-corrosion, anti-foaming, anti-scaling, so that they are going to resist the scales deposition on the heat transfer surface. And the patents of using nanofiltration, researchers in SWCC, Saline Water Conversion Corporation, have filed a patent or more talking about nanofiltration of the seawater before it is admitted to thermal desalination systems. We have filed a patent in the department here, but that was by one of your colleagues in his master thesis. He was working on covering not nanofiltration, but we're talking about microfilters that are given that are covered by a layer of graphene oxide, reduced graphene oxide, several layers of graphene oxide that can control the size of the molecules that pass through. And we found out that ultra filters, which are much cheaper, coating them with reduced graphene oxide is going to have exactly the same results that you could have get with a nanotechnology filter. But with almost 1/5 or 1/5 of the power required to do that. Accordingly, we proved that, it can be a substantially effective process in segregating out the ions that would result in scaling. If you are going to get rid of the sulfates, the carbonates, the manganese, the calcium, then basically you can increase the temperature and will not be worried about scale formation. So we showed that this can be done, and the study showed that we can go for even a temperature of as high as 160 degrees centigrade, which is going to increase the flashing range. You can increase the number of stages and have your GOR value that can be substantially increased according to the utilization of this, this kind of technology. Now, back again to the issue. As the seawater is being heated to the top brine temperature, it is entering through a pressure-reducing component. You have studied the orifice meter in your fluid mechanics courses. You have studied the Venturi meter. What we have here is something similar to that, but we call it weirs. Weirs are more used by civil engineers for conduits of water. But it can be also used in mechanical systems. So you have a weir here, which is a pressure reducing device. Why do we need to reduce the pressure? Because as you are working with low pressure, you can easily have vapor formed. But the phenomena here of multi-stage flash desalination system is dependent on flashing. What flashing means? It means that you have a saturated liquid that has been entered suddenly into an area of lower pressure. What will happen? Flashing will occur. So vapor is going to form, and this vapor was going to rise up. It will pass by a mist eliminator here to make sure that no water droplets are carried by the vapor. And the vapor is going to condense here to produce water. Then the quantity that will not flash, that will not evaporate, is going to undergo a pressure reducing device again, so that you reduce its pressure, so flashing again would occur into a lower pressure. Vapor will condense and you are getting water here. Then going from here to the next stage, flashing is going to occur again and vapor will form. Now the multi-stage flash desalination system, it may have systems that can have up to 40 stages, 40 stages. And in every stage, flashing occurs and you are getting more and more vapor to the extent that the last effect can be operated in vacuum. And when it comes to the classification, what we see in front of us here in this figure is what we call once through system. Why do we call it like this? Because the seawater enters here. It is going to recover heat of the condensing steam. So it will be preheated a little bit, preheated again, preheated again, and then heated in the brine heater. And then it will flash and flash and flash. And after that, it will be thrown away. It will be dumped to the surrounding. So we call it once through. Water has gone to the system. It has undergone different processes, and then we threw it away. Are there other systems? Yes. There is the famous system which is adopted here is what we call brine recirculation. Remember, you are going to throw away water that did not evaporate, but this water has received enough chemicals for anti-corrosion and anti-scaling. So you have spent some time, some investment on this water. Why should we throw it away? Why don't we just mix it with some fresh seawater so that you reduce its salinity and then you pass it back again to the system? And here comes the idea of brine recirculation MSF desalination system. The other technology that we have here as thermal desalination system is the MED, multi-effect desalination system, which is this. The idea is brilliant. It is simple. What happens? We don't have a brine heater for this. But what happens? We are bringing steam. Here, remember, we said that we are getting steam from a back pressure turbine. The steam will be heat the top, the salty water to top brine temperature. The steam will condense. You're turned back again to the power plant so that you will not disturb the mass flow rates in the power plants. The same thing applies here. You are bringing a line of steam from the power plant, but you are not going to enter it into a brine heater. You are going to take it to the first effect immediately. Steam is passing inside the tubes. And outside the tubes, you are spraying seawater on the outside surface of these tubes. The tubes are having steam inside, which is quite hot, and seawater, which is being sprayed, it makes a film over the surface of the pipe, a thin film. It's easy to heat the thin film and evaporation would occur. The vapor that will form here is going to rise up in this upper part. Whereas the steam that we borrowed from a power plant, it will condense and will return back again to the power plant. But we have generated enough vapor. The vapor that will form here, we need to condense it to become desalinated water. How to condense it? We are going to take it to the next effect. So the vapor that has formed in effect number one is going to move as vapor to effect number two, where seawater is being sprayed. So what will happen? It will condense, giving off its latent heat to the seawater film on the outer surface. The seawater film is going to be heated to saturation temperature. Part of it will evaporate. And the condensate here will be collected as product. The vapor that formed here is going to be the source of heat for the next effect. So it will condense, given off the latent heat for sensibly heating the sprayed seawater to saturation temperature and then evaporating part of it. As it condenses, we are going to collect it as a product and the vapor is going to the next effect and so on. So the process is being repeated. The good thing about this point is, or this technology, let's say that you have 1 kilogram per second of steam that you brought from a power plant and entered here. It is going to generate almost 1 kilogram per second of vapor. When it condenses in the next effect, it's going to produce almost 1 kilogram per second of vapor. Then, as this condenses, you are getting this vapor condensing and generating another 1 kilogram per second of vapor. So here for 1 kilogram per second of steam, you have in this small figure generated 3 kilograms per second of sweet water. If we have 4 effects, it will be 4 kilograms. 10 effects, 10 kilograms. So each effect increases the performance ratio or the goal of the system by a value of one. This is not happening in the MSF. And that's why the MED you can find the system is made up of maximum 8 effects. Whereas here you can have up to 40 stages in the MSF system. Yet you can find the goal of this system higher than the goal of that system, because there is much better effectiveness of utilizing the energy here. You take the energy, you generate steam, and that steam is the source of energy for the next effect. Generate steam, this is the source of energy of the next effect, and so on. And at the end, whatever condenses here is whatever you are going to collect as sweet water. Typically, we use almost 8 effects and no more. Why 8? Because the flashing range is limited here. In the multi-stage flash desalination system, we are talking about a top brine temperature that can reach 120, or maybe now it's 120. But here you cannot increase the temperature of the seawater to more than 70 to 80 degrees only. Why is that? A reason would be, in this system, seawater is passing inside the tubes. And for the MSF, it's a typical procedure that we have small balls, like the squash balls. You send it inside the tubes for cleaning, so it does cleaning while in operation. But here we don't have that. What you see here in front of you is the old technology where the tubes are immersed in salty water. But the new technology is that having tubes that are horizontal and the seawater is being sprayed on top of them. So we're talking about the seawater on the outer surface of the tubes. You cannot clean it while it's operating. So what you need to do? You need to shut down the unit, clean it, and then put it to service again. So that is the reason why we have a limit on the top brine temperature of the MED system compared to the MSF system. But for each one of them, there is a substantial role of energy recovery. Here, energy recovery is being used for preheating the water. Here, the energy recovery is better used by having the amount of vapor that we created here is going to condense, creating a similar amount of vapor that will condense and create a similar amount of vapor. So the issue of energy recovery in the MED system is the strongest among these ones. Any questions?
Yes, Doctor, I have a question.
Yes, for them.
Yes, Doctor, in case of HDH, which scheme is better when both fluids are heated or a single one is heated?
Actually, this depends on several factors. I'll give you examples of this since we have done quite a bit of work with the HDH system. When we are going to do theoretical analysis, thermodynamic analysis for an HDH system, we find that the best system is what we call a modified air heating system, a system which is similar to this, but we move the solar collector in between the humidifier and dehumidifier. When you do a thermodynamic analysis for this, it gives the best results. But when you put that on the ground, the situation is completely different. Why? Because you can easily heat the air. Air has a low value of specific heat, 1.005 kilojoule per kilogram Kelvin, which is the CP, whereas water has a value which ranges between 3.8 to 4.2, depending on the salinity of the water. So it takes more energy to heat the water compared to heating the air. But water can keep the heat, air cannot. You have heated the air, and then the air has gone into an increase in the area as it is flowing. Suddenly it loses the energy. So it's very simple, very easy for air to lose the energy it has gained. So when you are talking about practical systems, experimentally working on your build the system, then you find that the best is going to be the water heated system. Even it is used for the air conditioning purpose. In huge buildings for air conditioning, what you do, you bring a vapor compression unit and you refrigerate water. And then you take the cold water into pipes that are passing through a multi-story building. And in each story, you put an air handling unit so that you can make use of that cold water. So if you need to transmit energy, water is a better transmitter, much better compared to the air. air requires lots of energy to do that, and it loses its energy easy. So what is better on the ground is to do water heated system. I hope I answer your question.
Thank you, doctor. Thank you, doctor. Doctor, another question is, regarding air conditioning, MED and HTH both can be used. Which one will be better? Do you have any idea?
Actually, in terms of energy efficiency, the MED is far better.
Okay.
I have to tell you that in terms of the value of the GOR or MED is better. In terms of the productivity, for the high scale productivity, you cannot go for HTH to give water for a city, for example. No, this is a system that can be done for a small community, maybe a compound or a village or with a limited number of persons. But if you are looking for mass production, then you have to consider only MED. I would say MSF also, if you can use it efficiently. So small to medium scale, HDH is fine. But for large scale, you cannot use HDH for it. One more thing I have to mention here. We are talking about what is the superiority of these systems compared to the HDH. Now I was talking about the issue of scaling and heat transfer surfaces that would be affected of scaling. So they will have to put a limit on the temperature, maybe sometimes limit on the salinity. And if you are talking about having a salinity of 70,000 ppm or more, you cannot use RO, you cannot use MSF, you cannot use MED, because this water is too saline and it may result in corrosion definitely, but not for the HDH system. The HDH system is easy to build and all the components are made of plastics. They are non-metals. Accordingly, you do not have a problem dealing with high salinity water. And this is the area where the HDH cannot be beaten compared to the others, that it can, literally speaking, it can deal with any quality of water. All you have to do is just a little bit of filtering and that's it. Then you can operate the unit with any high salinity range of seawater, not seawater, but we are talking about rejected brine, we are talking about frack water. And the most famous application, practical application for the HDH system is a company that was a spin-off of our research work with MIT. It's called Gradient. And Gradient is basically working on frack water treatment, not in desalination. Although the work has started with desalination, but they found that there's a better market that can generate much more fund if they dealt with frack water. Frack water is the water which is used to be injected to increase the recovery of oil. And then due to water interaction with the rocks, it goes out with very high salinity, extremely high salinity, something in the order of 100,000 ppm or more. And you cannot use MSF, you cannot use MED, you cannot use RO. So the more significant or more successful applications is the humidification dehumidification system. The GOR of typically for a multi-stage flash desalination system is somewhere between 6 to 9. Although I have to say that the work that we have done a couple of years ago, no, it was not a couple of years, it was just last year, actually 2019. And one student has did his master and he showed that you can reach with an MSF to a GOR of about 14, which is substantially high. That's unbeaten record for the MSF. For the MED, we are talking about 65 to 70 degrees centigrade and you cannot go more than that. Why? Again, because spraying of seawater is occurring on the outer surface of the tubes. You cannot cleaning while operation. You have to separate it and clean it and then put it to service again. Having a thermovapor compressor is going to improve the performance, and we will be seeing that in details when we get to the study of detailed desalination systems, and we'll see how combining a system with a thermal vapor compressor can make a difference in its operation. Developing countries have problems related to water. And for them, it's not only that you need to look for a source of getting fresh water. but the source has to be economic. It should not be requiring a huge budget to do that. One of the projects when we started with MIT, there was a project that was given to the students over there to come up with, it was a, like a course project. There's a problem in Haiti of shortage of water, come up with a cheap solution for that. So that was the challenge. You need to bring a technology to an area which is poor. They cannot build a highly expensive desalination unit because they cannot afford it. So what you need to do is to come up with a system which is easy to build, cheap, does not require technical know-how to maintain. And meanwhile, it can produce water effectively. What I have just mentioned now can be applied on solar stills, but they have low performance, and it can be applied on HDH systems. So the HDH systems would be a very good solution for small villages in rural areas where even you don't need to have fuel for heating it and you can rely on solar energy, because basically you need water at a temperature of about 70 to 80 degrees centigrade. This is all that you want in order to desalinate the unit or desalinate that kind of low quality water and bring a good quality of water that people can drink. And it's not sophisticated technically, so people can maintain it easily. You're just basically having a fan that rotates the air in a unit. So the air will carry the moisture from one component, which is the humidifier, condense it and give off the moisture in the dehumidifier, and then it will rotate again in a closed loop, for example. Some emerging technologies are there. Forward osmosis is not an emerging technology. It has always been there. It has been used. It has been used even in several applications, but using it for desalination and combining the forward osmosis with several desalination technologies is a very good idea. And there is some work that has appeared in the literature in the last few years talking about forward osmosis as a promising technology for desalination. There is one master student who's working with me currently in relation to the forward osmosis, and we try to operate the system so that we are trying actually to make a model for it so that it becomes cost effective and energy effective. Membrane distillation has been very successful in the pharmaceutical and the juice extraction industry, but it has recently been there in water desalination field. And currently there are some spin-off companies in several places in the world that are producing we can say low scale units of, or up to medium scale units of productivity with membrane distillation. The other good thing about membrane distillation is that you don't need to heat the water to more than 70 to 80 degrees centigrade. So again, low grade energy is acceptable for this. Nanoscale desalination, thermoionic desalination processes, low temperature thermal desalination. By low temperature, we mean like desalination by freezing. And this would be an interesting topic to consider, that to bring this, why desalination by freezing? Because I just said previously that if you're going to heat the water to the extent that vapor is going to rise, vapor is pure. When you condense the vapor, then you are getting pure water here. Freezing is similar. When the water is freezed, it is separated from the salt. Then you can wash the salty water that is being frozen. And as you wash it, you are going to get rid of the salt. Then when you melt it, you are going to have pure water. Is there another benefit out of this? Yes. The latent heat of solidification is almost 1/7 of the latent heat for evaporation. So this can be some sort of a very effective way to desalinate water at lower temperature, but there's a challenge. How can you make this issue of freezing and melting and separation continuous? How you are going to freeze the water? Are you going to freeze it by a vapor compression system? Then you are going to talk about high energy consumption again. Maybe freezing by evacuation, by reducing the pressure. Why not? That looks like a good idea. but you have to apply vacuum. And then when you apply vacuum, how you are going to collect the water in? So there is a challenge here in how to build a system that can adopt the issue of desalination by freezing. If somebody is interested out of the group here to investigate this area more, that would be nice to see. Just look at the work that has been currently made on desalination by freezing, and maybe come up with a layout of a system that can do that. Capacitive deionization, it's using basically electrical field for separation of the salt water from the pure water, or salt ions from the pure water. Solar desalination, this is typically a field of desalination that can cover everything. It can cover MSF, MED, HDH, solar cells, even RO if you are going to use a solar PV system. So this is a very wide range. And what we are talking about solar desalination here, it is using solar energy in any one of the different technologies for desalination. Dew evaporation is another emerging kind of technique, because water vapor in the air is a tremendous quantity. If you can create a cold surface that will condense water vapor from the air, especially when you are talking about humid cities like cities on the seashore, like the Dammam and Khobar, like Jeddah, these are places that can be very humid in summer and definitely very humid in winter as well. So if you are going to create a cold surface for water vapor in the air to condense, then this is going to be, actually, they are now in the market, even commercial units that are selling dew evaporators. They are just selling units that you can get water from the air. Geothermal desalination, if you have a geothermal plant in which you are having hot water coming from the underground, then you can have a source of energy for a desalination system. We'll try to touch on some of these during the course. Maybe you can, for your term project, other than the list that I made available, you might be interested or intrigued to work in one of these technologies. That would be interesting. This is some sort of a classification of various desalination systems by technology. You can have, for example, talking about a large scale system versus a smaller scale system. That could be a part of classification. Large scale system, for example, for cities, the MSF, the MED, the reverse osmosis, utilization of vapor compression, maybe electrodialysis, where it, so far there's no unit that can produce or can bring mass production, but there's a potential for that. On the other hand, the smaller scale units, you'll find here that many of these are given detailed description of solar stills, for example, whether they are passive or active, whether they are limited to a certain temperature or not, single stage, multi-stage, do we have some sort of trials for energy recovery or not. The HDH units will be here as well. Solar desalination or solar thermal in desalination systems can be direct for solar stills and HDH, or it can be indirect by solar thermal using flat plates or evacuated tubes and so on to run existing desalination systems, including the conventional ones like RO. So you can have a PV system which is operated by the sun to generate electricity, and the electricity can run an RO system, for example. So the classification here is based on the size and the energy input. Another classification can be made, a mechanical system versus a thermal system. And once I make the book available on the internet, on the Blackboard, you'll find that the first chapter ends with some sort of a classification of desalination system, which is basically thermal versus non-thermal. On the non-thermal, basically the focus is on RO. So what we have here is some sort of an introduction to the desalination in general. What we are going to do from our next week, inshallah, is start on each one of these technologies that we'll be visiting for a while. We'll start by the old technology of the solar cell. I hope that it will not take more than one class from us talking about the solar cell types and the basic modeling equations for a solar cell. After that, we'll be dealing with the HDH desalination system. After the HDH, we're going to spend some time on the HDH desalination system, talking about the various layouts and recent trends in operating HDH system. We're going to talk about operation as well as design. Maybe after that, we can move to the membrane distillation system, look at the layout, the classification of MD systems, and a basic model of one or two of these classifications. Then we can probably move into the conventional desalination systems, which are the MED, the MSF, and the RO. We'll also talk about economics of desalination. And probably I'll just repeat again what I mentioned last time, that we might be able to invite external speakers who have done some sort of substantial work related to desalination in different areas, and let everyone give us something like maybe 45 to 1 hour of talk to the latest technology that has developed in thermal desalination. That would be it for the introduction. There are some elements in the introduction that I did not talk about so far. For example, talking about the quality of water after being desalinated. Are we looking for water with no salts at all? We might be doing that, but not for drinking. This can be good for a feed water heater, for a boiler in a power plant. But for us to drink, we need a certain quantity of salts because our bodies need salt. Water without any salt is acidic, and that's not good for our health. Even when you get like a bottle of mineral water, look at the ingredients, which are getting small in the size of the bottle. I may be putting a photograph or taking a photograph of one of these bottles and putting it in blackboard. You'll find that it has total dissolved salts. The total amount of salts in there will be in the order of 120 to 130 ppm. And this is needed for our bodies. The reverse osmosis system can bring up to 500 ppm. We can tolerate up to 1000 ppm. The optimum is 150 or 120, but we can even withstand up to 1000 ppm. Above that, it is salty water. It is basically brackish water up to 10,000 ppm concentration. Ppm is parts per million. It's a volumetric way of measuring it. And then the seawater is about 28,000 for the Atlantic Ocean, 45,000 for the Gulf here. And the rejected to the sea from power plant does not exceed the value of 70,000. Then it's too concentrated brine there. Another fashion that has appeared last year is the interest in what they call brine mining and the zero liquid discharge. So that the brine which is being rejected to the sea is of high concentration of salt. It might affect the marine environment. So how can we protect the marine environment from very high concentration of salt, which is dumped back into the ocean by concentrating it further, maybe through another desalination technology, and after that using a crystallizer so that you can convert the salt into crystals, and the crystals can have an economic value which is too high to the extent that if this a project like this is successful, you will not have a problem in distributing the pure water for free, because all the profit is going to be done from the crystals of salts, which are needed very much for many, many industries. And I might be calling Dr. M, which is one of the experts in the Research Institute of SWCC, in one of our lectures. I hope that he will have the ability to join us once and talk about their activities in this regard, which is substantially some sort of an important application to consider, which is a project of desalination system, the rejected brine will not be thrown away to the sea, but it can be made use of again by recovering some sweet water out of it, further concentrating the salt, and then using a crystallizer to convert the salt from high concentration solution into crystals, and the crystals will be sold separately with a very large margin of profit. That's it for today. I'm going to stop here and thank you for joining this class. I would probably remain for maybe a few minutes if somebody has questions or so. Thank you. I'll stop recording as well.